Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus in the gospel reading today starts out by asking a simple question. Just a simple question of identity. Who do the crowd say that I am? Kind of simple, isn't it? But this simple little question brings a plethora of answers, a variety from John the Baptist to a resurrected prophet. And as a good teacher, Jesus redirects the question to his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And this gives one of the great moments in the Gospels, the confession of Peter. You are Christ of God. What should interest us here is Jesus' answer. I mean, most of us today wanted to hear what St. Matthew has to say. On this rock, Peter, I will build my church. But that's not what we hear today. In fact, what we hear is it's a little confusing. Maybe it's what we hear is a little scary. We're not quite sure why Jesus answers Peter's confession with what he says. First he tells him, be quiet, don't tell anybody. Then he tells him about his death. And then he says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. This is a rather strange response by Jesus. I mean, maybe for many of us it brings a little fear and trepidation, a little confusion. I mean, what does he mean? We must deny ourselves. What does he mean to take up the cross? Not just once, but daily. What does losing our life have to do with following Jesus? I mean, what do all of these things have to do with Peter's confession? What is it that Jesus is trying to teach us out of Peter's confession? Well, he's teaching one thing, that as we confess who he is, the world's response to us will not be a happy response. The world will hate us for our confession of Christ. We can see that. It's evident today. Around the world, we see it. Take Canada. There, it was just decided by their Supreme Court that to speak out against homosexuality, for a pastor to call homosexuality a sin, was to break the law. They can no longer say that in freedom. It's kind of a scary day. But we can get a little closer to home. Here, Christianity is under attack. It's vicious attack. The atheists have come after Christianity. Last Christmas, they wanted no nativity scenes. They wanted them removed. Cases were filed against churches to have nativity scenes removed around the country. They want to see freedoms limited on Christians. We can go to the military, where Orthodox Christians have been labeled as subversive and as a threat to homeland security. And there have been men who have been punished for displaying their Christian faith here in America. It's scary. It's frightening to think about that those things happen right here. We think of those things happening around the world, other places, but right here. This is scary. And all of these things are the things which Jesus is talking about. These are the crosses that we will bear, along with our other crosses of our sin and the sickness and death that comes with sin. We bear these crosses for our confession. Now, here in America, we've not faced death as many have around the world, but there might come a time when we do just that. So in light of all this, one thing is amazing to me. Why aren't we all pessimists? You don't meet many pessimist Christians. Why is that? I mean, as we look at it, is there really any hope for us? I mean, aren't we just stuck facing a world that hates us? We're surrounded, we're trapped. It's kind of a gloomy situation. Is there any hope? Well, we're lucky we're not the first people to face a hopeless situation. There's another group of people who are faced by times of overwhelming pessimism, overwhelming doom. They were surrounded by nations that hated them, and they'd been promised that those nations would have victory over them. Without question, God had promised that. If you haven't guessed, it's the nation of Israel. God was going to punish them for turning away from him. And so, they were facing a hopeless situation. And I'm sure they were a little pessimistic about it. God says they're going to win. You have a tendency to believe it. Just the way it is. But listen to what our Old Testament text has to say about this. And the Lord will give salvation to the tents of Judah first, that the glory of the house of David and the glory of the inhabitants of Jerusalem may not surpass that of Judah. God has promised them salvation. God has promised that he would save Judah and Jerusalem, that he would save the Israelites from their enemy. In the midst of their despair, their misery, they are given hope. Hope to face their enemies, just as we are given hope in the midst of our misery to face a world that hates us. Ours comes in the gospel reading. And he strictly charged and commanded them to tell this to no one, saying, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. Kind of great words of comfort and hope for us Christians, as we look here at what we know is going to happen. Our hymn today, the sermon hymn, was great in this. I didn't even know this was the sermon hymn today, so your guys' pastor picked a great hymn. He says, in verse 3, let us also die with Jesus, his death from the second death, from our soul's destructions, free us. Quickens us with life, glad breath, let us mortality mortify while living, flesh and blood die to sin. And the grave that shuts us in, shall but prove the gate to heaven. Jesus, here I die, to thee, there to live eternally. The hymnist hits this verse on the head. Our comfort is twofold. In verse 2, he also says, let us suffer here with Jesus. This is the first way that we have comfort. We suffer no different than Jesus did. Jesus became flesh and blood to take our sins, and he suffered. Our gospel today says that he will be rejected by the world, but not just the pagan nations, not just the world around him, but by the very people that he, as God, has chosen to be his chosen people. He will be rejected by the elders and chief priests and the scribes and will be killed by them. So, in the words of the gospel, we face the same thing. We are no better than our master. We face the same fate as Jesus. So we know that God knows what we are suffering. But that brings us to the second fold comfort that makes this one a little more comforting. Jesus just ain't going to stay dead. It's that simple. They're going to kill Christ. And 3 days later, our text tells us he's going to be raised from the dead. This is one of the predictions of Christ's death and resurrection. And here we find our hope. Here we find our comfort in the midst of the misery of this world, in the midst of the fear that we have as we face a world that surrounds us and hates us. Jesus is raised from the dead. I love the Easter proclamation. Alleluia, he has risen. He has risen indeed. Alleluia. Even now we can make that. Christ was raised from the dead. He became the master of death. Death did not master Jesus. Death did not get Jesus and hold him in. No, Jesus rose from the dead to eternal life. He is living now. As the Apostle Creed says, raised from the dead and ascended into heaven to sit at the right hand of God the Father. We know this is truth. We confess this to be true because it is. And this too is going to be the same fate for us. We, as the baptized children of God, are going to be raised to eternal life. That simple. We will live with Christ in heaven for all eternity. And so we face all the world can throw at us in this hope of the resurrection to eternal life. This is our hope. So we ask the question, how is it that we can lay our life down and follow Jesus? What does that have to do with it? Well, it's the truth. Some will have to. Many have become martyrs. Martyr is it's a Greek word that simply means witness. Many have made witness in their death to their faith. This has been their confession. And how have they been able to do this? Simply because they have the hope of the resurrection to eternal life. There's nothing to fear in death, for death has been defeated. We do not die the second death, as our hymn said, but we die to eternal life. But it's not all doom and gloom. Many of us will never face death at the hands of those who hate us, or even really any persecution. Many of us will go through our life not facing those things. But this hope of eternal life is still what drives our ability to confess, our ability to tell the world who Christ is, the very Son of God who came to die for our sins, to bring life to a dead people. So, in the end, we don't have to be eternal pessimists. Just simply we don't, even as we face this world that hates us. We live in hope because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That each of us has this. That each of us will be raised to eternal life in Christ. And here becomes our defense for the hope that we have in the gospel. We have life. Life eternal with Christ in heaven. Amen. Now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.